grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
His mercy endures forever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare for the Paschal feast, continuing in the Apostles' teaching and fellowship and in the prayers, let us make ready our hearts to renew the covenant of our baptism. Let us kneel as Abel before our Creator and Redeemer. Let us ask God to bring to light the things now hidden in darkness, and to disclose to us the secret purposes of our hearts. And most especially, let us remember the covenant of our baptism and test our hearts and conscience to know how faithfully we have proclaimed by word and example the good news of God in Christ. Holy and immortal God, you formed us from the dust in your image and redeemed us from sin and death by the cross of our Savior. Through the washing of baptism, you raised us up with him to share in the new covenant with all your holy people. But we have squandered the inheritance of your saints and have wandered far in a land that is waste. Therefore, we turn to you in penitence and humility. In your great mercy, forgive us and restore us, that we may rejoice in your presence and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son was revealed in majesty before he suffered death upon the cross, give us faith to perceive his glory, that being strengthened by his grace, we may be changed into his likeness from glory to glory, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
I'm reading from the book of Genesis. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty, walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be an ancestor of multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made the ancestor of multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nation of you. Kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you through their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be to God to you and to your offspring after you. As for Sarah, your wife, you shall call her Sarah, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nation. Kings of people shall come from her. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
We beheld him despised and rejected, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief.
We beheld him despised and rejected, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief.
Praise the Lord, you that fear him. Stand in awe of him, O offspring of Israel. All you of Jacob's line, give glory.
For he does not despise nor abhor the poor in their poverty, neither does he hide his face from them. But when they cry to him, he hears them.
My praise is of him in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the presence of those who worship him.
The poor shall eat and be satisfied, and those who seek the Lord shall praise him. May your heart live forever.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. And all the families of the nations shall bow before him.
For kingship belongs to the Lord. He rules over the nations.
To him alone all who sleep in the earth bow down in worship. All who go down to the dust fall before him.
My soul shall live for him. My descendants shall serve him. They shall be known as the Lord's forever.
They shall come and make known to a people yet unborn the saving deeds that he has done.
We beheld him despised and rejected, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Corinthians. The promise that he had inherited the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendant through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. It is abhorrent of the law who are to be with the heirs. Faith is none, and the promise is void. For the law bring wrath, from where there is no law, neither there is no violation. For this reason depends on faith, in order that promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all of his descendants, not only to the upheart of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations in the presence of God in whom we believe, who gives life to the dead and calls for existence to things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, so numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already dead, which was already good as dead. For he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, for he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, it was reckoned to him, were written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for the trespass that we was raised, for our justification. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus began to teach his disciples that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the angels." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise
to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I expect many of you have heard the story, possibly even from me, about the pious Christian who finds himself and his house in the path of rising floodwaters. When the official vehicles come through the town to take people to shelter on higher ground, he declines because he trusts that God will save him. The water climbs partway up the first floor, but when the rescue boats come around, he doesn't go with them because he believes that God will intervene. Eventually, he finds himself on the roof, but when a passing helicopter lets down a ladder, he refuses to take it because he knows that God will look after him. Finally, he drowns. And when he comes face to face with his Maker, he complains, Lord, I believed that you would save me. What happened? What happened, says God? I sent you an SUV, a boat, and a helicopter. I'm reminded of this story whenever I hear self-proclaimed Christians protesting against lockdowns or masks or vaccines, because God will reward their faith by protecting them without the need for such artificial methods. Silly as the first example is, and disturbing as the second is, they do have something to say about the nature of faith and about how we understand it. In the Epistle to the Romans, Paul is very anxious to show that faith, unlike the rigid structures of the law, brings freedom. But in his account of Abraham, he ends up making faith sound like something static and immovable. Abraham did not weaken in faith. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. This gives the impression that Abraham's faith was something unchanging, even unreasoning. And the danger of that sort of belief is that you end up like the man in the flood or the Christians protesting lockdowns. Of course, we know that Abraham's relationship with God was one of deep trust, but it also involved questioning and doubt and protest. The first thing that happens in Genesis after the passage we heard today is that Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said to himself, "Can a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? Can Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child?" These are reasonable questions. And God did not punish Abraham for asking them, any more than Mary was punished for saying to Gabriel, "How can these things be?" Questioning and doubt are not the opposite of faith, not the enemies of faith, but rather the ground in which faith grows. Faith is not the conviction that certain things will come to pass, so much as an abiding trust in the goodness and mercy of the God who loves us. Peter, in our gospel today, has not yet reached this understanding. His experience of the person and ministry of Jesus has brought him to a point where he can say, when Jesus asks, "You are the Messiah." But all his training has given him a very fixed idea of what such an identity implies. Faith in the Messiah means, for him, a belief that this person will triumph over earthly rulers and restore the kingdom of David. Everything Jesus then tells the disciples, that he will suffer and be rejected and imprisoned and executed, is so much at odds with the way Peter understands who and what the Messiah is, that he seems not to hear the final part, that after 3 days, Jesus will rise again. He has decided what God will do and rebukes Jesus for describing something different. We all do that sometimes. We wish for something so powerfully that we decide God will bring it about, and then we give God instructions accordingly. Many people call that prayer. And when they discover that God doesn't actually take directions from us, they lose their faith. The trouble with that is that their faith was never in God so much as in their own expectations. And on a more complex and subtle level, when we commit ourselves to work for something we strongly believe in, we have to try to discern what the shape of the kingdom looks like in the moment, in the place where we are, and pursue what we believe the will of God to be. Sometimes there are transformations which seem almost miraculous, but most of the time, practicing ministries of care or working for peace and justice can be slow, difficult, and fraught with setbacks and delays. And if this reality challenges the image of God we've constructed for ourselves, that can tempt us to give up, to lose our faith in the real and living God who calls us into relationship. The crucial thing to remember about prayer and care and activism is that our minds, like Peter's, work in a much smaller arc than the unfolding of God's kingdom. And what looks like failure or unanswered prayer to us in the short term is still part of the great divine trajectory. We can have faith in the love and mercy of God and act according to our best discernment. We can also question, like Abraham, like Mary, and listen for the whole answer, as Peter in today's gospel seems unable to do. This interplay of openness, questioning, and discernment, informed by a trust in God's unfailing care for creation, is what we are called to, what we are invited to participate in as children of God and followers of Christ. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen.
We will live in dignity.
let us confess our faith as we say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
God of the covenant, you call us to be fruitful servants within creation, and to offer our lives as the foundation of your realm. We lay before you the desires of our hearts, that we may be transformed by their fulfillment. Let us pray, saying, merciful God, hear our prayer. Holy God, during this period of Lent, give us a new awareness of your presence in our church, St. Theodore of Canterbury, and in the world. Teach us the humility to accept that all our gifts come from you to be used in the service of your people and in the spreading of your gospel. Merciful God, hear our prayer. We remember before you the leaders of our church, the Reverend Andrea, the Reverend Carol, our bishops, Kevin, Andrew, Anne, and Linda, our parish vestry meeting taking place later today, our parish family, Ramesh and Rachel, Jacqueline, Linda, and our companion diocese of Grahamstown, South Africa, and Iglesia Anglicana of the region of Central America, and the work of the refugee, Don Valley Refugee Resettlers. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Creator God, your Son walked upon earth and taught us to seek your hand in the beauty and wonders of earth, sea, and sky. Help us to recognize our presence in our modern world, your presence in our modern world, to be good stewards of your gifts. We pray for all the areas of the world impacted by climate change, the loss of livelihoods, and loss of homes. Merciful God, hear our prayer. We pray for Eileen, Elsie, Gloria, Jean, Louise, Olive, and Sylvia, the residents of Sunrise of Thornhill, those who are lonely, those isolated because of ill health. Lord, in your mercy, merciful God, hear our prayer. Father God, we give you thanks that we are able to share our space with Father Nestor, our sisters and brothers of St. Seraphim of Sarov, the Movement of Truth Mission, the 18th Willowdale Scout Group, and Willowdale Early On Child and Family Center. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we pray for the sick, the suffering, the anxious, remembering particularly Judy and all who are listed in our prayers, those whose names are written on our hearts. And as we journey through this time of pandemic, of COVID, we pray that their sufferings may be lightened and they may all experience the light of the gospel. Merciful God, hear our prayer. We pray for all who administer to the sick and the infirmed, those working in our local health centers and hospitals, those working in care homes, and those who provide daily care at home. Grant them strength and grace. Merciful God, hear our prayer. We pray for all who are in prison, persecuted, forced to flee from their homes, those living in refugee camps, and we pray that all who govern might do so with justice, mercy, and humility, remembering the stranger at the gate. Merciful God, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the ministry of music that comforts us during this time of virtual worship, our music director and the choir. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Almighty God, be near to those who are grieving today over the loss of a loved one. We raise before you those who have died due to COVID in the faith of Christ, and for those whose belief is known to you alone. We thank you for those who have traveled before us on the way of the cross and are now at peace in your eternal presence. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Grant, O God, that the prayers we offer may be your channel for new and abundant life, not only hoped for, but worked for, through faithful word, through all our small acts of sacrifice and deed, that we may be cheerful in our fasting and giving as our Jesus Christ has commanded us. Accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
As our Savior taught us, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Glory to God, whose power, working in us, can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. May the God of mercy transform you by his grace, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Serve our ever-present, ever-loving Lord, observing a holy Lent.
Thanks be to God.